Well, I thank the Lord every day that I do this. It's really a good feeling to work slow, watch it just come together, and hear that first tune you play. I was about 6 years old, and it was the first music I had ever heard. We didn't have a radio in the family until 1939, but we had a great aunt that played this guitar, and a neighbor played the fiddle. And I think my prayer was that the Lord would let me do a little of it. And he did, and I still enjoy it. About 1960, I ordered one from a K banjo from Sears and Roebuck. And I think it in the case, the picks, and a little instruction or something, run about $29.95. Well, my grandmother said, "You have lost every bit of the sense you ever had for spending that kind of money on a banjo." We raised six children, and they were all in school in the late 60s, in the 60s, you know, when I first started out. And I got to noticing them at night after I had supper. I'd go get my banjo and I'd see them putting their hand upside of their mouth and saying, "He's going to get that old banjo." So they wound up putting me in the storm cellar. They said, "You just got to go from here. We can't study and you doing all that." So I stayed in the storm cellar a couple of years.
When the saints go marching in.
I was going by my ears, what I was picking up, but I was doing a two-finger roll instead of a three-finger roll, and I'd worked on that about, probably 6-7 years and had it down. I was playing some tunes, you know. But then I found a little course. It was three pages in the little old grit paper. And it was from just outside of Atlanta. And I think it was $2.98 or something like that. But I ordered that. And that got me set straight on the roll patterns. So I just sat down and started learning the rolls. And somewhere about 1969, they said I was pretty good. So we formed a little band called the Craftsman Group. It was a bluegrass gospel, and a cousin of mine played the mandolin, and a friend down at Laurel played guitar, and another cousin on the bass, and they had me on the banjo. We were then on the beginning of some of the festivals, first festivals that started, and we had the opportunity to be on the program with Lester Flatt in the Nashville Brass, and that was a great honor for us. I didn't hunt and I didn't fish or didn't play golf. So I needed something to do. Spring of 1971, I was sitting around one Sunday afternoon and I was looking at this old K banjo that I had bought. And I said, "I might be able to build one of these." So I went out and I didn't really know anything about how to do how to let wood dry or anything. So I cut down this little poplar tree and I whittled out a pretty little neck. And I laid it on the workbench and went back doing something else on the rim for the banjo. And 2 or 3 days later, I noticed that the head of that neck had split, because it was drying And I said, oh, I'll just quit this now. But I happened to think I had a pretty piece of walnut. So I went back and made the neck out of the walnut and went on and built the banjo. That fall, I don't remember how long, 3 or 4 months working on it. Then I hid that banjo. I didn't want anybody to see it. And that Christmas, dueling banjos and Beverly Hillbillies and everything was just burning the air up. And a friend of mine in Newton came and said, I can't find a banjo in Meridian or anywhere. And says, my son, I'm going to get him one for Christmas. So I said, well, I got one I made. He said, well, bring it and let me look at it. And so I did. And he said, that's what I want. So that's the way it started. And then in 72, I built 2 banjos that year. I found when I built that first banjo, and I was a little bit on the edge, you know, building the first one, but the second 2 banjos, I really noticed a big change that I really was relaxed and I was felt good about what I was doing, and time passed fast, you know, and I found it was a great patience builder. You know, we all are trained to get on jobs to work fast and turn out good work, but they want you to work fast. But this work, you can't work fast. If you do, you wind up in trouble. I read As a Man Thinketh back in the 50s, right after I got out of school and started to work. And that just made more sense to me than anything I had ever read. Cherish your visions. Cherish your ideas. Cherish the music that stirs in your heart. The beauty that forms in your mind. The loveliness that drapes your purest thoughts. For out of them will grow all delightful conditions, all heavenly environment of these, if you but remain true to them, your world will at last be built.